Dear brothers and sisters, I want to welcome you to attend our online service. The Bible says that we must give thanks to God. We must thank God because He has done wonderful things in our lives. If your wife has cooked a very delicious dish, do you thank her? Or do you say that's just her duty? If your boss has given you a 6 months bonus, do you thank him or just keep quiet? If a stranger has lifted you when you fell down, do you thank him? I'm sure you will thank these people. Do you thank God for the blessings He has given to you? Do you thank Him for your safety, for your health, for your job, for your academic results, for your parents, for your marriage, and for your children? What do you do if your son were to show you his beautiful painting? I'm sure you will praise him for his creativity. What do you do if your girlfriend wears a very beautiful dress? I'm sure you will praise her. What do you do if your architect friend comes up with a very innovative design? I'm sure you will praise him. Do you praise God for the things He has done? Look at the world. You can see clearly God's wisdom, creativity, and power. Look at the tiger. Look at the leopard. Look at the Arctic fox. Look at the red panda. And look at the owl. Aren't they beautiful? These are just a few of His beautiful creation. Look at the Amazon forest. Look at the desert. Look at the waterfall. Look at the mountain. Look at the Milford Sound in New Zealand. Look at the Northern Lights and look at the galaxies. Aren't they beautiful? The words of God are perfect and beautiful. We should not keep quiet. We must praise Him for His power, wisdom, and creativity. Let me say the opening prayer. O Lord our God, we want to praise You for Your greatness. You are the creator of the universe. You created all things in heaven, on earth, and under the earth. You created things that are visible and things that are invisible. You created the rulers, the powers, authorities, and the spiritual forces in the heavenly places. Everything exists by Your will, pleasure, and purpose. You appointed Jesus to be both Lord and Savior. He is the Lamb who carries the sins of the world. He has risen from the dead and triumphed over sin, death, and the devil. He is our High Priest who makes intercession for our sins. He is our Shepherd who cares for us. He is now exalted to sit at Your right hand. He will come back to set up an everlasting kingdom. We praise You for our rich spiritual inheritance in Jesus. We praise You for Your great power and mercy. We believe that You are faithful and nothing can separate us from Your great love in Christ Jesus. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We will ask Joshua Lee to lead us to sing two songs to worship the Lord. For information, Joshua Lee is a lawyer with a legal firm. His wife is Hua, a Vietnamese.
Breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that You would take my place, that You would bear my cross. You would lay down Your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that You've done for me. Of chaos back into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter. The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of His brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. that you will take my place, that you will bear my cross, you will lay down your life, that I will be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Amazing grace, this is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. This is amazing grace. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Thank you. would shout your praise forever. I would shout your praise forever. I was made to worship. I was made to bless your name. My heart and flesh cries out for you to fill me up. You satisfy me. Fill me with power and truth. Fill me with love from you. And you satisfy me. My heart and flesh cries out for you to fill me up. Satisfy me, fill me with power and truth, fill me with love from you. You satisfy, and I will bless the Lord at all times. I will bless the Lord at all. Shout your praise forever. I will shout your praise forever. I was made to worship. I was made to bless your name.
Today, we have Mr. Peter DeRoon to share God's word with us. He served as a pastor for many years, and now he is doing motivational seminars. He will speak to us about charting the way forward, based on Philippians chapter 3, verse 13.
Welcome in Jesus' name. Now, I'm going to read a verse which I will be using as the basis of the sermon, and then after that, we'll go straight into whatever I need to say, okay? The verse is from Philippians chapter 3, verse 13. But if you have time, it'd be good for you to read verse 12 and verse 14 as well. Philippians chapter 3, verse 13. Brothers, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it. But one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead. Now, you may be thinking, why am I having this verse? It's to answer a question that you might have heard or a question you might have asked yourself. Questions such as, now what? What's after this? Where will I go? And what will I do once this is over? Or what's the next step? I'm sure you have heard such questions. You know, when you finish Form 5, the question will be, where are you going next? You finish your higher education, what are you going to do? You begin work, what's your plans next? There's always this question about the future, about your way forward. And I find many Christians find it difficult to answer that question. So using Philippians 3 verse 13, I would like to give you a few pointers. So if you're ready, let's begin. Okay, pointer number one. what you think you are less about in your present situation, in your present condition, could determine what you want to do or should do in the future. Yeah, let me read it again. What you think less about your present self determines what you want to achieve in the future. Now, you saw the beginning of this verse that Paul wrote. He said, I do not consider myself yet to have taken. Yeah, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold. In other words, he is saying, I don't think I have. I don't think I am. I don't think I can. And that's a very good place to start when you think about your future, when you want to plan ahead. So my question to you is, when you look at yourself, what do you consider yourself yet to have taken, yet to have achieved, yet to have? In other words, what is less? What is lacking in your life today? Now, once you can identify that, the next question is, do you want to have what you don't have? Do you want to achieve what you've not yet achieved? Do you want to see what you have not seen or experienced? If your answer is yes, then why not make those your future goals, your future targets? You see, many people have no idea what they want to be, or who they want to be, what they want to do or have in the future, because they have not looked at their present self. So Paul said, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold. And the word taken hold is capture. So he's saying, I've not yet got, I've not yet caught, I've not yet owned this thing that I want, this thing that I want to see, I want to experience, I want to have. Do you know what you have not yet taken hold, but you would love to take hold? You would love to have, you would love to own. All right? Now, what is it that in 1 year's time, 3 years' time, 5 years' time, 10 years' time, you would like to have, to own, to see, to experience? Think about it. Because only when you know that, can you plan for your future. So some of you may say, I consider myself less educated. I consider myself less beautiful. I consider myself less experienced. Oh, great! Because every one of that is a clue as to what you could work towards, make the effort to catch in the future. If you consider yourself less educated, do you want to be more educated? If you consider yourself less beautiful, do you want to make yourself beautiful? If you consider yourself less healthy, do you want to be more healthy? Because what you think less about your present self is a great clue as to what you could aim towards, work towards in your future, to create the future self you want. So that's my first point from Philippians 3 verse 13. But Paul doesn't end there, right? He then says, but one thing I do. So he begins by saying, I realize I've not yet achieved this. I realize I don't have this. I realize I've not captured my goals. So what do you do? He says, one thing I do. And this is another reason why we don't capture what we want for our future self. Because we do not say, but one thing I do. Usually we say, but 101 things I do. We are so scattered. We are doing 101 things, hoping some of these things will work so that tomorrow or next year, we will be a better person, we will achieve our goals, we will capture what we are trying to capture. But if you ever try to catch more than one bird at a time, one chicken at a time, one rabbit at a time, you run around trying to catch every rabbit, every chicken in front of you, the fact is you won't get any. You got to stop and decide, okay, maybe I got 3 things I want in the future. Maybe there are 5 things I want to achieve in the future. But the big question you have to ask is, what's the one thing that I must do today? What's the one thing that I must focus on today? And to answer this question, I'm stealing a question from a famous book called The One Thing. This man wrote this book called The One Thing and he's become a very famous man, and it's a very famous book. And it's based on the idea, this one thing I do. And how do you decide what's the one thing I do to create the future self that I want, to capture things in the future that I want to have, I want to experience, I want to own? Okay, what's the question? Well, this is the question. You could ask this every morning. You could ask this when you are planning, or you could ask this when you evaluate yourself, hopefully once in a while. Okay, this is the question. What's the one thing I can do such that by doing it, everything else becomes easier or unnecessary? Huh. Okay? So you may say, Pastor, I got so many things to do, ma. Don't know which one to focus on. My answer is, okay, look at all the so many things you have to do and ask this question. What's the one thing here in the so many things that I can do that if I do it, everything else becomes easier or unnecessary? When I first started using this question, actually it was quite hard to answer. It was quite hard to answer. Why? Because I had never trained myself, I never trained my brain to evaluate and to decide what one thing I would do. I thought being busy and trying to do 3, 4, 5 things all at one time or in one day would help me reach my goal and help me catch what I want to catch faster. Of course, that didn't work, right? So, but once you practice, you become good at it. Now, I want to share something else also, which I found interesting, because not only as a pastor, I'm also an English teacher, and I love languages, and I love English. And, you know, in English, there is this word called priority. So this one thing I do is, which one is your priority? But the word priority actually comes from the word prior. Huh. And prior means before other things. Before other things. So, when you decide your priority, you're actually deciding your one thing. Before all the other things you do in life, before all the other things you do today, which one is prior? Which one is the first thing that you should do, must do, do it well, complete it? Then the others can follow. If not, you will have complaints like, "Haya, so much things to do, ma. Ayo, no time, ma. Haya, my brain want to explode, la. Oh, so tired, la." Paul knew this. So he said, "But one thing I do. One thing I do." So, if you think, "I don't consider myself an educated person," that's a clue. Maybe what you want for your future is to be an educated person. Great. Now you ask yourself, what's the one thing I can do today? And remember, the word is can do. Not what I wish I like to do and all that kind of thing. No. But what one thing you can, you are able to do. What one thing I can do today that will help me be a little bit more educated compared to yesterday? What one thing can I do today that will make it easier for me to be educated? You see? So, this is a vital question. This is an important question that has to become a habitual practice if you are going to go forward, if you're going to get hold, if you're going to catch what you desire in life, especially if you desire to transform yourself from what you consider not yet to now having, owning, experiencing, being all that you were not before. So, just in case you forgot everything, let me repeat. In order to move forward and to become your future self that is amazing, first thing, what do you think less of your present self? Is a clue of what you could do to become more in your future self. Secondly, once you decide, these are the things I want to achieve because today I have not. These are the characteristics I want to have because today I have not. These are the things I want to catch hold of because today they are not mine. The next question is, what one thing can you do so that you are closer, one step, 10 steps, but closer to becoming and having what you desire. And focus on that one thing. Okay. And lastly, at the end of this verse, Paul then says these very interesting things. Yeah? He begins with, "I consider myself not yet. So this is one thing I do so that I will have." And then he ends the verse by saying, "Forgetting what is behind and straining towards what is ahead." The last thing is, he says, "And for all of this to happen, I am going to forget what is behind." What does that mean? In simple English, forget your past. Because so many of us live in our past, we memorize our past, we believe our conclusions about our past, and the scariest and most dangerous thing is, we use our past to determine our future. Paul remembered his past, used his past to decide whether he will be a good evangelist, whether he should go and reach out to the Gentiles, whether he should be a spokesman for Christ. I think his answer will be, cannot lah. I'm not qualified. Or worse, you know what I did last time? These are all comments by people who always go back to the past, refer to the past, and let the past decide their future. But Paul said, I forget the past. I forget what is behind me. Yeah, I forget what is behind me. Now, you may ask me, Pastor, why should I forget the past? Well, I'll give you three things to consider. First, looking backwards prevents you from going forward. Right? Looking backwards prevents you from going forward. Have you ever seen someone who's driving a car? And as he drives, he looks at the side mirror, that tells him what is backward. He's driving his car supposedly forward, but he's using the side mirror that shows him what is back to drive. What will happen? An accident. Or he could kill somebody. Nobody drives his car forward by looking backward. You will never bring yourself forward into the future that you want, that God wants for you, if you are constantly living in the past, remembering the past, and looking back to the past. Next point is, which was very hard for me to believe, you know, because people keep telling me this. But the next point is, your past does not determine your future. Some of you may say, yeah, I agree with that mentally. But honestly, I find too many people, including myself, cannot believe this. Your past does not determine your future. I have students, when I was a teacher, who would tell me, teacher, I'm stupid. So, if I get lousy results, don't be upset, huh? So I ask, how do you know you are stupid? Well, last year, when I took the test, I failed. When I was in primary school, I took the test and I failed. And because I failed in the past 2, 3, 4 times, I am guaranteed to fail in the future. I am sure I will fail in the future. Some of you listening to this may laugh and say, no lah, how come you say that? But don't you think many people say that? They look at their past, especially their past failures, and they say, therefore, today cannot, tomorrow sure cannot. Today sure fail, next week also sure fail. Yesterday was impossible, so tomorrow will be impossible also. If you have that kind of belief, basically what you're saying is, my past determines my future. But do you realize that between past and future is present, is today? And actually what you do today can break can break whatever is negative in the past, so it does not need to continue in the future. Which brings me to my third point. The only thing you carry forward from your past are lessons learned that will help carry you forward. The only thing you carry forward from your past, the only thing you don't forget from your past, are lessons learned that will help you carry forward, will bring you forward. Paul did not forget all his rabbinical training. He sat under some great teachers. His knowledge of the Old Testament was amazing. And he did not throw that away. He actually used that and brought about so much wonderful explanation and teachings from the Old Testament that is now in the New Testament, that has become part of our theology and our faith. But to move forward, to achieve what you want to have, to be, to experience, you got to put the past in the past. But he didn't stop there, right? He says, forgetting your past and focusing on the future. Or he used the word straining towards what is ahead. Oh, I love that word. He said, straining towards what's ahead. What is ahead? Everything that I want to be. What is ahead? Everything that I want to have. What is ahead? Everything that I want to be. What is ahead? Everything that I want to achieve. What is ahead? Everything that God has for me. But for that to happen and for you to experience that and to have that, he used the word straining towards it. And to make sure I'm correct, I checked the dictionaries. And this is the meaning of straining. To make an unusually great effort. Okay, so you realize you are less educated. And you realize the one thing that you need to do is to sign up and take a degree. And once you do that, you forget your past. Yeah, last time you failed, last time you couldn't finish your first degree that you took. Forget all that. But now, you got to strain forward. You got to make unusually great effort. And I find in the end, we are not who we are. We are not where we are. We are not experiencing what we should be experiencing. We're not having what we're supposed to be having. For one simple reason, in the end, we did not make the necessary, unusual, great effort. Effort that demands strength, resources, and abilities. So when somebody asks you, so what's next? What are you going to do next? What's your plans for the next few years? Part of your answer is, I'm going to work really, really hard. I'm going to put in unusually large amounts of effort. I'm going to draw on all my strength and the strength that God gives. I'm going to use all the resources available to get it, to achieve it, to become it. And that's what Paul said. So in one simple sentence, Paul revealed a three-step process that all of us need to take if we want to become the person we wish to be. We want to have what we don't have yet. We want to get hold of what we don't have in our hands yet. First is recognize what you don't have and decide what you want to have. Then focus. Decide what's the one thing that you should be doing in order to make it happen. And lastly, take great steps, unusually strong effort. Do whatever is necessary as long as it's legal. Work hard until the desired future is yours. So whether you are a young person, just finished studies and going to work, whether you just started work and dreaming about the future, or whether you've just retired and wondering what's next, the answer is always the same. Consider your present situation. Decide what one thing you can do, and then put in all the effort necessary to make it a reality. God bless you, and I hope this lesson helps you.
We will ask Joshua Lee to lead us to sing the closing song, and after that, I will make the announcement.
Let our King be
If you have been encouraged by the message, please share with your friends. You can click the video button to watch other messages by us. We wish to express our condolence to Mr. Jimmy on the loss of his father-in-law, Mr. Jiki, on 16th of May. Due to infection, Jimmy was very committed to God when he was a teenager, but lost his way for more than 20 years. He came back to the Lord 2 years ago after attending a meeting. He said that after the meeting, he slept so well. He said he had never slept so well prior to him coming back to the Lord. Some of you may have serious challenges, marital, financial, children, or others. I urge you to go into fasting. Queen Esther called for a fast when the Jews encountered a crisis. Haman was about to launch a nationwide campaign to kill all the Jews in Persia. She called for a fast, and the Lord answered by destroying Haman, and as a result, they were delivered. When Israel was invaded by the large swarm of locusts, the prophet named Joel called for a fast, and God said that he would drive the locust army into the sea. Isaiah in chapter 58 also said that when we fast, our prayers will be heard. Isaiah chapter 58 verse 9 says, "Then you will call, and the Lord will answer. You will cry for help, and he will say, here am I." The pandemic is getting more and more serious. The daily fatalities for COVID patients are very high. Where family members who are old and not so well, I think it's not enough for us just to pray. We need to fast. I'll be fasting on 27 May, that's Thursday. I'm praying for more to be saved and to be healed. If you have a serious need, you can call me and I can include you in the fast. But I want you to pray or fast with me too. Some of you ask the church to pray for you, but you need to attend the prayer meeting too. People will take you seriously when you attend. We must also know that there's power in agreement. Matthew chapter 18 verse 19 says, "Again, truly I tell you that if two of you on earth agree about anything they ask for, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven." Now I'm assuming that you are healthy as I give you this advice on fasting. To fast, you don't eat for 3 meals. Drink enough water and break the fast the next day by eating oats or porridge. Spend a lot of time reading the Bible and praying. If you have a medical condition, you can consider the possibility of a partial fast by eating less or with a bit of fruits or biscuit. I will pray publicly by the church Zoom link from 8 p.m. to 10 p.m. on Thursday, 27th of May. You are welcome to join me. We are fighting spiritual powers. They are called rulers, authorities, principalities, powers of this dark world, and spiritual forces of evil. They are very evil and the origin of human problems. We must not think that they will leave you alone. No, they won't. They will come for you, whether you like it or not. To defend yourself, you need to live a holy life and have the Word of God. But you also have to pray. You need to pray in the Holy Spirit with all kinds of prayers. If you don't pray, you will be hurt by them. Some of us hardly pray, and as a result, we never become fruitful or effective. There are very few blessings when we don't pray. When you pray, God will work and bring more blessings and richer spiritual experiences into your lives. When we pray, we are walking with the most powerful being in the universe. He has life. He has love. He has mercy. He will help us. He will open doors for us, and he will give us surprises. There are certain blessings that we can't have until we go deeper into God. God be serious with those who are serious with him. When you counsel and pray for people, you need to remember one important principle. You need to be a good listener. Some of us cut in and start to give advice before we heard the person through. This is a cardinal sin in counseling. Proverbs chapter 18 verse 13 says, "To answer before listening, that is folly and shame." When we counsel people, let the person talk. Don't interrupt. Try to understand the person. Very often, people want to be heard and to receive sympathy or understanding. Just use this common sense. If you like to talk and be heard, know that the other person is no different from you. He or she also wants to talk and be heard. Why not give him the blessing of a listening ear? If a pastor is talking to a person, don't take over. Respect authority and order. If you have important piece of information to give, ask the pastor for permission. Now, this principle should also apply to old wives. Over the years, I've noticed some wives who talk or interrupt when the husbands are talking. Now, this is very bad. First, it's very irritating. How to listen to two voices at the same time? Second, you belittle your husband in the eyes of the listeners. Your husband is the head of the family. When your husband is talking, don't interrupt him. Exalt him in the eyes of his listeners by letting him finish his talk. After he has finished, you can come in and fill up what he missed. I will say the closing prayer. O Lord, we thank you that you are full of love and mercy. Thank you that you never reject those who come back to you, but you will welcome them with open arms. Thank you that you can restore us no matter how broken our lives might be. You can rebuild the broken ruins and make us beautiful again. We will no longer be bound by our past failures, but be bound by your cords of kindness and good purpose for us. We pray for our nation. We have seen a huge surge in the pandemic cases. We pray for your mercy. We pray for your protection and power to cover us. Be our shield and fortress. Help us to overcome the various social, financial, health, and physical challenges unleashed by the pandemic. We believe that you will hold our hands and carry us through. Help our government to take effective measures to bring the pandemic under control and to complete the vaccination program. We also pray for the people of India who are going through hard times. Help the government to deal with the pandemic. Comfort those who have lost their loved ones. May the Holy Spirit open their eyes and lead them to Jesus, who can give them true comfort, peace, and fulfillment in life. We also pray about the conflict between Israel and Palestine. Help the peace envoys to get the two countries to reach a solution to the conflict. Jesus has come to save the Jews and Gentiles so that he could form one new man out of the two. May the Holy Spirit work among the Jews and the Palestinians to bring them to Jesus, the Prince of Peace. We thank you for hearing our prayers. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.